This episode of Podcasts from the Past was recorded on June 17, 1977. Please remember to follow Tim and Mike on Twitter at TimPillary and at MichaelOHaver1. And while you are at it, follow the show's page at Podcasts from the Now. Button your fucking lip and let this show wash over you like a warm summer breeze.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to Tim and Mike's Entertainment Show. We have got a great show for you here today. It is June 17th, 1977, and we saw The Exorcist 2 today. I am your host, Tim Pillary. And with me, as always, is Michael O'Haver.
Say it. Welcome, America. Welcome to our show.
Welcome, world. World. This is a global show.
We're international now. That's right. I forgot. Welcome, world.
Tell them how many million listeners we have now, Mike.
25 million listeners by my last count.
That's only overseas.
Right. That's just including Anglo-Saxon, so it could be scores more.
Yeah, it definitely is. Today, special guest, we have NFL running back O.J. Simpson. He is a hero around these parts. USC great O.J. Simpson. And of course, to talk during the Exorcist 2 segment, we have the real-life Regan MacNeil on. Linda Blair portrayed her in the films. The real life Regan MacNeil. We might get a little spooky today. We are talking about the devil, the boogeyman, to be more specific. This song, of course, is I'm Your Boogeyman by Casey and the Sunshine Band. It is the sound of your summer, 1977. The number one hit in the country. Don't you love this song, Mike?
I love this more than anything else I've heard this summer, that's for sure.
Anything else I've ever heard. Yeah, it is a hot summer out there. All right, well, let's bring on NFL running back O.J. Simpson.
Hey, yo. How's it going?
Welcome.
The juice is loose.
Oh, I'm loose.
He's extremely loose.
Oh, yeah. What's going on, Tim?
Nothing much. It's intimidating when you say my name, I gotta say.
Tim.
Whoa. I'm taken aback a little bit.
You should be.
I wish I was behind the glass like Mike is.
Yeah, it's funny. They say the camera adds 10 pounds, but in your case, you look much bigger in person than you do on television. This is amazing.
That's a nice glass you got there, Mike.
Thank you very much. Yeah, it's here for my protection. I'm a bit of a germaphobe.
Understandable.
You are very imposing in person. I agree, Mike.
Thank you, Tim.
You want to intimidate people.
Oh, yeah. What I really want to talk about is Star Wars, though.
Oh.
No, that's not something we can bring up.
Oh, I love that movie.
Oh, well, yeah, of course, everyone is loving Star Wars. It came out a couple months ago. We reviewed it on this show, and we really, neither of us liked it at all, actually. And
yeah, it's a bit of a stinker.
Yeah, I mean, I'd rather talk about...
I think you guys are mistaken.
I'm sorry, but are you going to stand the entire interview?
Oh, this yeah.
It's weird with you just standing here.
Well, I like to stand.
No, okay, I mean, I meant no offense. It's just, I mean, you know, if you want to sit down, we have several chairs, there's a couch.
It's just sort of an aggressive stance when you're telling us to like the movie Star Wars when we just didn't.
Well, you should.
Fair enough. All right. I mean, maybe I'll give it another watch. I saw it twice in the theaters.
I've seen it 17 times.
You saw it 17 times?
Yes.
Okay.
I thoroughly enjoy it.
But you're not one of the big fans, though. Because, like, one of the big fans, they
see
it.
What are you saying? I'm not Big Tim?
No. I mean, you're a big guy. I'm just saying you must not be one of the big Star Wars fans because they...
What are you saying? I'm not a big fan, Tim?
Let's move on to current events.
You kind of did imply that he was small.
Back me up.
Yo, Tim. Small in stature, but big in intelligence. He was implying you were intelligent.
You're an intelligent OJ.
What Thank I said you, made Tim. No sense. Please Thank don't you. Beat us up, sir. Don't beat us up.
Does OJ stand for orange juice? I've always wanted to ask you.
It actually stands for Orange Julius.
Do you
I said it, okay. I don't want to contradict you. I said it at the beginning of the show. From my understanding, it stands for Orenthal James.
That is a wrong understanding, Mike.
My apologies.
Yeah, motherfucker.
Orange Julius.
Okay. Well, okay. That's all right.
Listen to him.
Wow, you've never cussed at me like that, Tim.
I will fucking break out these brass knuckles, you motherfucker.
That's what I'm talking about, Tim. That's what I'm talking about.
Right? I will fucking... I got all these pens on my desk right now. I'm gonna fucking come over there and stab you with these pens if you don't recognize.
Tim's got some anger in his eyes.
Yeah, Mike.
I know anger when I see it.
Good luck getting through this glass.
Yeah, it is bulletproof. I know. We had it installed on purpose.
Tim, may I have a sip of your Yoo-Hoo?
Yeah, sure. Here, go for it. How does it taste?
Delicious.
I beat a dead horse, but I would think... It's O.J. Simpson, Orange Julius Simpson, would be partial to orange juice, not Yoo-Hoo.
What? He didn't have any orange juice. He had Yoo-Hoo.
Okay, fair enough.
I don't like your mic guy.
No. No one does, actually.
Right, yeah. Nobody liked.
No. Okay, so on to current events. On June 5th of this year... The first Apple II series computers went on sale. Now, Mike, I'm not sure what you think about this whole Apple and this whole, whatever they're calling it, computer thing. I think it's a fad and a whole big waste of money, you know, for everyone involved.
This is going to be garbage. Time will tell. I mean, what are we on? Star Trek, beam me up, beep boop beep bop beep. I want a computer. This is stupid.
R2-D2's one smart computer.
Okay, I mean, I'll give you that. He was a smart computer, but that was a fictional, you know, that was a movie based on fiction
what,
in the future.
What are you saying?
In real life,
what are you saying,
nobody
Mike?
Wants a computer. Nobody wants a calculator.
What is this word fiction?
That, okay.
It means when something's true, when something really happened.
Okay, that's categorically wrong.
Thank you,
wrong.
Tim. Thank you for explaining the meaning of fiction to me.
It's like your NFL career as a superstar is a thing of fiction. That's
which means true.
Yeah.
Thank you, Tim.
Mm-hmm. No problem. Right. Shut the fuck up, Mike.
Okay. All right.
Me and OJ are gonna break this through this glass any Jeez. Second now.
And I'll murder you.
Whoa, actually.
Okay.
Let's
a very...
Yeah.
It's what I say. It's my thing.
Okay.
Wait, murder's your thing?
Yeah.
NFL running back, O.J. Simpson.
I will murder the defensive line.
Oh, he's talking about... Oh, so
figuratively.
He's saying he's going to run through you like you're a defensive lineman or something, or a linebacker, or whatever they call it.
Thank you for speaking for me, Tim.
You're welcome. I know you. I feel like we're into this together, me and you. OJ.
Tim, you're getting weird.
Sorry. Yeah, I'm just trying to side with you over Mike, because Mike's a fucking dick.
I agree.
Okay. There's an energy happening right now that I don't agree with. I understand, you know, you're pumped up by this man's testosterone. There's a huge, tall black man looming over you. You have the need to feel strong. You know, you don't usually threaten me like this, and that's fine. But, you know, I just kind of want the energy of the show to become a little more, you know, laid back. I mean, we're, you know, this is the 70s, the greatest decade of our time.
You're right.
We watch movies for a living.
You're right. Okay. Let's loosen it up a little bit.
Yeah.
Sorry for all the aggression. Let's get back to these fucking stupid computers. Ugh, yes. I just want to punch these guys in the face. I just want to smash all these computers.
Yeah, OJ, my advice, some financial advice, pull all your stock in Apple. Sell it, you know, invest in soybeans or something worthwhile, plastic.
I actually got...
Don't invest in this company.
Thank you, Mike.
I think that's good advice. I actually got offered some Apple stock recently at a conference I was at for $1 a share, and I laughed the guy away out of the conversation. He wanted me to buy 1,000 shares, and...
That sounds stupid, Tim.
I was like, yo, motherfucker, I'm going to dope slap you right here in this conference hallway.
Yeah, you should tell him you're going to murder him.
Yeah.
All right. Well, first of all, you were right to turn him down. But I mean, you said, "Yo, motherfucker, I'm gonna dope slap you." That does not sound like something you would say.
Yeah, that's my Tim. That's my Tim.
Just met him today.
Yeah, and he's my Tim.
We've been learning from each other.
All right.
it might have been some version of that I said.
Okay.
Something like that, somewhere in that neighborhood.
It's just not very like you to just cuss someone out for trying to sell you some stock, some bum stock. Don't get me wrong. It was a stupid idea. I might have been infuriated myself.
Oh, I was pissed.
Yeah.
I was pissed. Do you own any Orange Julius's?
I own 7.
Only 7 out of the 700 worldwide?
Yeah. You got a problem with that?
I guess I don't have a problem with it. I mean...
Seems like you got a problem, Tim.
No, OJ.
I'm starting to like you, Tim.
OJ...
Starting to like Mike a little bit more right now.
Anyone who owns more than like 8 Orange Julius is a jive turkey as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah, that's right.
Exactly.
Yeah. I will murder anyone that has more Orange Julius than me.
Just, you mean in business?
Yeah. His
Or like maybe if I had a cup and I
will
had
crush
the large
his business.
Orange Julius and you had a medium Orange Julius, you would kill me for that?
Yeah. Most definitely, Mike.
I just think he means he'd put you out of business, is what he's trying to say.
Yeah.
Right. Like, he would literally kill me, but he would buy up all my stock in Orange Julius if I had a bigger glass of Orange Julius.
Yes, I will force you to foreclose on your home.
Wow, that's... Okay. All right. That makes sense.
Your life will be murder.
Okay.
Back to current events. On June 10th, Martin Luther King Jr. Accused killer James Earl Ray escaped from Brushy Mountain State Prison in Petros, Tennessee. He was recaptured, however, only a few days later on June 13th, and he was apparently headed to Los Angeles to appear on Tim and Mike's entertainment show. We have a quote. As he was getting dragged in by authorities, he was quoted as saying, "Those guys have all sorts of killers on. Why not me? I didn't want to shoot anyone. I just wanted to talk about Star Wars." And he was later actually overheard saying that he was thinking about shooting Mike if he did make it to the studio. But that wasn't really confirmed.
Right. And this was, he called me that night and he cleared that up. When he said shoot me, he was going to shoot me like film. He was going to shoot a short film of him and I. And for him to say that we've had killers on before, I took a little offense to that, and I brought that up to him. First of all, there's never been a convicted killer on this show.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. There's been some misunderstood individuals. What he said, I think maybe was taken out of context. Mm-hmm. You know, those guys have killers on the show all the time. I think what he was trying to say is that's a killer show. That's a killer show.
I agree. 50 million listeners couldn't be wrong. I think he might be talking about Ted Bundy. We had Theo Bundy. He's a buddy of ours back a few years ago. And he's not a convicted killer. He is being tried for murder, though. But he is definitely not guilty. We met him. He's a really good guy. He's definitely not guilty. So for James Earl Ray to say that, yeah, it was pretty rude. Out of line, I thought.
James Earl Ray, we don't want to talk to you about Star Wars, and I'm not going to shoot that short film with you.
Good.
He's a good filmmaker.
Yeah, from what I understand, but still.
And on the phone now, we've got a caller. Usually we don't take calls during the show, but we have a very special guest of ours, speak of the devil. We have Theo Bundy on from prison. Ted Bundy, say hi.
Hey, everybody. How's it going, guys? Good to hear your voices.
Ted, I just want to introduce star running back O.J. Simpson is here in studio with us, along with myself and Mike here today.
What's going on, Ted?
O.J., hey, you're awesome, man.
Thanks, Ted. You're a good guy.
Yeah, we were actually talking about you, Ted, because James Earl Ray had said that he wanted to appear on our show, and we were wondering what the connection was. And he basically said that we like to have killers on and kind of pointed towards you.
That's just crazy. That guy is nuts.
Yeah, I mean, he's a murderer, Ted. You're not. Like, we've met you. You're a nice guy. There's no way you could have hurt anyone.
Yeah, I don't know what it is with people, but, you know, I'm just an ordinary guy.
Now, what do you think about this new legal trouble? You think you're going to be able to get out of this, Ted? I know you recently escaped from prison and got recaptured. It was a close call. I mean, I think everyone was rooting for you to have run away forever, but they got you, and...
You know, these guys are idiots, you know? They're the kind of guys that lose the keys to their car every day, you know? They can't keep an eye on anyone.
Now, Ted, where were you going when you escaped from prison?
Well, you know, I missed being in L.A., and I was heading over your guys' way. I figured we could hang out. Did you guys see that new movie, that Star Wars?
Oh, yeah, we saw Star Wars, Ted.
I loved it.
That was awesome.
O.J. loved it, too. We didn't really like it that much, though.
You guys are crazy.
Yeah, we missed you, Ted, but we hated this movie.
It was a piece of shit.
Well, it still would have been good to come hang out.
Now, aspiring politician Ted Bundy, when you are cleared of charges, are you going to resume your political career?
You know, I think I might, but, you know, I'm thinking that maybe I should be, I don't know, maybe like a car salesman or something else. I don't know.
Now, how do you plan on getting out of these legal charges?
I'm not sure how it's all going to turn out, but I mean, clearly I'm innocent, so...
The evidence will prove you're right.
Yeah. Ted, we're behind you 100%, and can I make a suggestion? You're a pretty smart guy. I mean, I know you very well. Why don't you represent yourself? I mean, you could probably represent yourself better than any lawyer.
You're making a good case right here on the show, Ted.
Yeah, you know, maybe you guys have something there. I mean, you know, I'm smarter than the rest of these jerks.
Now, OJ, what do you think about this Ted Bundy case?
Yeah, he innocent.
Okay.
Yeah, from your lips to God's ears.
Yeah.
Ted Bundy is innocent, says OJ Simpson.
Let him out of jail.
That sounds like a threat.
Maybe it is, Tim.
Well, I don't have the key.
Well, I don't think he was threatening you to let him out of jail. I think he was saying, you know, America, let Ted Bundy out of jail because I, O.J. Simpson, believe he's innocent.
Don't tell me what I'm thinking, Mike.
Fair enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, I got a great idea for a bumper sticker that'll say, "I'm a lover, not a homicidal maniac."
That's a brilliant idea.
Yeah.
Sounds good, Ted Bundy.
Put it on the cars.
I'd put that on my Bronco.
You know, I wish that Darth Vader could use the Force and just get me out of this prison cell here.
Star Wars, you know, compared to The Exorcist 2, is just a piece of shit. No one's ever going to care about it. You know, Exorcist 2 is a great film that's going to stand the test of time, Ted.
Yeah, did you like it more than the original Exorcist?
It blew it away.
Yeah.
This will be John Borman's calling card.
Yeah. Maybe I should say that the devil's doing all these things people are telling, you know, me I did. That's crazy.
Well, thanks for calling, Ted. We have to get to The Exorcist 2, but thank you very much. We support you, Ted. We're behind you.
I appreciate that, guys. I really do.
Well, thanks
a
lot.
Free Ted Bundy.
We're going to get t-shirts.
I already have a t-shirt that says Free Ted Bundy.
Hell, awesome. OJ's on my side.
Of course. You're one of the good guys.
You guys are awesome.
Call us again, you know, when your trial is coming up. We'll give you a pep talk, okay? And best of luck.
Yeah, sounds good. Yeah.
See you, Ted.
Well, that was pretty weird, getting a random phone call from Ted Bundy from prison. So he used his only call to call us. I'm kind of flattered, Mike.
Yeah, thank you, Ted Bundy. I'm sure when you hear this, like the 35 million other listeners, that you'll be grateful that we make this show for you. So you're welcome, Ted Bundy.
Fan of the show, Ted Bundy. Okay, now we have on a very special guest here. We're about to dive into The Exorcist 2, the spook fest, the horrifying new horror film, The Exorcist 2.
Scarier than the first.
By far. And today, a very special guest here on the show, we have real-life Regan MacNeil, portrayed in both films by Linda Blair. Regan, how are you today?
I'm amazing. Thanks for having me on.
Wow. I'm starstruck. I'm such a big fan of both of these films.
Great.
And you were amazing in them.
Oh.
What was it like to meet Richard Burton?
I've never met Richard Burton. I'm Regan, the character. I'm the person that the character is based off. That's not actually me. That's Linda Blair.
So you were possessed in real life,
right?
And these movies were both based on you.
Exactly.
So what was it like to be possessed?
Not fun.
Okay.
My question was better.
It was, yeah. Fair enough.
Yeah, I wouldn't recommend it. It's scary. And I will say this, though. My teeth were not that bad when I was possessed, as Linda Blair's are in the film. Just want to clarify that.
So you're saying your teeth didn't turn yellow and pointed when you were possessed?
God, no.
Okay. Because that happens in the film.
Mm-hmm. It does. I mean, that's kind of like, they take liberties.
Mm.
I mean, I was...
Did you vomit like her in the film?
I did.
That's disgusting.
And let me just say, don't eat pizza before you, you know, get possessed, basically.
So if anything, your teeth would be better because I hear the acids in your vomit actually whitens your teeth.
That's true. Studies.
I don't know if it whitens it. I think it actually messes with your enamel. But, I mean, you can ask any person you know who's bulimic. Like, it just messes with your teeth. It's not a good thing.
Studies have proven the complete opposite, actually. Science is out there.
Okay.
In Exorcist Part 2, you know, you were living in sort of a psychiatric home in almost like a fishbowl with these glass windows and everything like that. So I could understand why you wouldn't know. What was it like living in a fishbowl?
Well, again, they're just taking liberties. I mean, most psychiatric places don't actually have, you know, glass walls everywhere. You're in your own room. It's very private. I mean, it's a very scary thing. And when you're talking about this stuff, like, you need a safe place. So they're obviously, it's not a fishbowl. There are no clear walls. That's ridiculous.
Hmm.
But it looked cool on TV and on the film, so, you know. That's why they did it.
Mike, you were telling me before we started the show today that when you were in the psychiatric home, that was exactly how it was.
Yeah, when I was in the psychiatric home, it was like being in a fishbowl, but I was also part of an experiment. So it may have been a little different than her experience. I had signed up for some medical testing, some medical trial, and the name of the medical trial was... go live in a fishbowl until you get driven crazy by living in this fishbowl.
Mike's in a fishbowl behind that glass.
It makes me feel comfortable because of my time in the psychiatric institute. After keeping me in a fishbowl for so long, I got used to this way of life, so now I like to just be behind glass all the time.
Makes sense.
Do everything behind glass.
And that's why
we love to a woman behind glass.
And that's why we have the glass bulletproof, because when he was in the psychiatric home and a gunman came in and fired bullets through the glass, and Mike was shot a few times. Clearly he lived, but...
Oh, I'm sorry. That sounds horrible.
Well, it's not your fault. Yeah, several different people came in and tried to shoot me, actually.
Non-bulletproof glass triggers Mike's PTSD.
Anybody try to stab you?
Nobody tried to stab me through the glass. Several people tried to shoot me. A lot of my ex-girlfriends, ex-boyfriends tried to come kill me while I was in the psychiatric institute. And, you know, they almost succeeded. But I'm here, speaking to you today, behind this solid, bulletproof glass.
Sounds very, like a safe environment.
I feel safe.
I can't believe there weren't guards or other people to stop them from coming in and shooting at you.
Well, you were in one, too. I mean, when you were in one, could you imagine some guy with an Uzi, like a just this gun, just with automatic gun, just shooting a million bullets a second? That, because that's what happened to Mike. I shot so many bullets.
Yeah, that sounds horrible. Probably not as bad. The threat of being shot at, not as bad as, you know, I don't know, being possessed by a demon. You know, that's tough.
That was worse.
That was worse, yes. I'd say that was worse.
I can imagine, yeah. When I saw my good friend and radio co-host come in and try to shoot me with an Uzi, I was shocked. But I couldn't imagine if I weren't even there and coherent, if I were possessed and being shot at by my buddy, which obviously we patched things up. It was a big misunderstanding. They actually told him that I was possessed. So he thought if he killed me that he could save the world. So he came in and tried to kill me.
It was all for the sake of the show.
Yeah, of course. Yeah.
As I was firing
bullets.
You go
kill your partner, you go kill your co-host, and the show will live on. And he will do this show from the great beyond. He'll possess someone else.
As I was spraying bullets around that hospital, I was screaming, "This is for Tim and Mike's entertainment show!"
Yeah. Yeah. It was hard to understand you through the gunfire, but later, you know, in your manifesto, it was clear that that's what you were trying to do. And I dropped all charges.
That was nice of you.
The listeners appreciate it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Thank God the show could go on.
Okay. Now, Mike, are you nervous that that Regan MacNeil is here today? Because she has been possessed in real life, and I know that you're very spiritual.
I've got a theory, actually, on possession, and we have someone here that I'd really like to talk to about that.
Okay.
I think we've kind of, for lack of a better word, we've demonized possession in this country, being a Christian-based society. Whenever anyone gets possessed, it always seems like it's something evil. Why doesn't anyone ever get possessed and say, hey, you know, I want to go water skiing. I want to do something fun. You know, I want to go hiking. When someone gets possessed, all they want to do is go kill a bunch of people and their head spins around and they puke everywhere. I mean, what about the guy that gets possessed and he says, hey, you know, I just want to do people's taxes?
Regan MacNeil, what about that?
Yeah.
Well, the whole deal is that they're demons, and demons are bad. It's not like you're possessed by an angel. It's not, you know, a good thing. They're always bad. They're always going to come in. They're always going to want to kill people. They want to take over your body and take over the world. They're demons. Demons are bad.
Okay, so
demons don't like to surf and go skiing.
Interesting point.
Huh.
I'm not sure if I believe it, but maybe it's true.
Look, if I were to pass on and come back in another realm, in another life, I would probably like to go on hikes to some places that I haven't been. But I'm not a demon. So, there's that.
I think I get what she's saying. So, people that are good, they go to heaven or they go somewhere better, so they don't have to possess anybody.
Mm-mm.
So, the only spirits left that could possess people are evil spirits, and that's why whenever anyone gets possessed in this plane, they do evil stuff.
Yeah.
This conversation is above my head.
Yeah, I'm not sure what we're talking about anymore either.
Yeah, I think I just made a major breakthrough.
Well, let's get into The Exorcist 2, this classic film here. I mean, we all liked Exorcist 1, but seriously, Exorcist 2 is just head and shoulders above it in pretty much every which way. Directed by John Borman, who is a much better director than William Friedkin. Borman made Deliverance, of course, back in 72. This movie stars Linda Blair, of course, Dick Burton, one of our favorite actors. We've had him on a million times, Richard Burton. Nurse Ratchet was in the movie. Mm. And Paul Henreid, also a friend of the show from Casablanca. also James Earl Jones has a small role in the film.
Right, this is the role he will be remembered for, Exorcist 2.
I agree, and it's weird. He's had two roles this summer, one in a really great movie, Exorcist 2, and one in just an awful movie, Star Wars. But he played a similar role in both. I mean, he's kind of the devil in both.
Yeah, that's why I couldn't watch Star Wars.
It hit home.
It did. It's his voice. It's the creepiest thing in the world.
Did it trigger your PTSD?
It did. It triggered my PTSD. It's one of those things. As soon as I hear Darth Vader's voice, I'm like, oh my God, this is Kukomo, the same guy that was also possessed. The same demon that possessed me possessed the guy that James Earl Jones plays in the movie.
James Earl Jones reminds me of my father.
Because he's black?
No, because he's powerful.
Oh.
And because he's black.
Was he an athlete, like James Earl Jones?
Yes, very much so. He was very nimble, just like James Earl Jones.
I found it weird that James Earl Jones was released from prison to shoot both of these movies. Now, he was the guy who shot Martin Luther King Jr., right?
No.
I was mixing up Earl Ray and Jones. Right. James Earl.
Same guy. James Earl.
It's not the same guy?
No, sorry.
No, that's the same guy.
It is the same guy.
Oh, yeah.
Obviously, right? How could there be two guys named James Earl something?
I don't know.
They're very uncommon guys. Name.
Yeah.
Sure.
James Earl Jones and James Earl Ray are the same guy.
I mean, I think so. Clearly.
Except one's black and the other one's not.
I don't really see the world through that lens.
That's racist.
I mean, I'm just pointing out facts. I don't see color either.
That's okay, right. White girl.
You like okay, white girls, well, so that's good.
I do. I got intense lust for white girls.
Wow.
That seems highly inappropriate.
Well, this, you know, we like a little love connection here on the show.
Just stating facts, Mike.
If it happens.
Right. Many people have made a love connection on this very show. It's true. Ted Bundy met a number of his girlfriends on this show.
Hmm.
Maybe that's it.
Okay, now, with The Exorcist 2, the subtitle here is called The Heretic. Exorcist 2, The Heretic. What do you guys... What do you think the heretic means exactly?
Well, I mean, I think that's to do with the religious connotations in the film. The heretic, you know, The Exorcist 2, The Heretic.
No,
I'm just repeating what you just said.
I have here as a definition of heretic as a man who rides horses in competition.
No.
Yeah, that's what it means.
I was wondering why we didn't see any horse racing in The Exorcist 2.
Well, I think what it's trying to, you know, say is life is a horse race. Exorcist 2 is life, the heretic, the horse race.
No, I don't think, no.
Regan MacNeil, what does the heretic mean?
It's a person who is possessed.
Are you possessed currently? Is that how you know that answer?
Not currently, not right now. I mean, it comes and goes. I haven't had a spell in a while, but...
Regan MacNeil, I have a problem with the term, she speaks in tongues. Isn't it true that everybody speaks in tongues?
No. Mm-mm.
But we use our tongue.
You do. All right, that's a good point. But no, we don't speak in tongues. I speak in tongues, technically, when I'm possessed, but right now I'm not possessed. You're not possessed. The other guy's not possessed.
We're not sure about Mike, actually.
Mike, right.
Mike, how did you feel about the candle throwing in the first scene of The Heretic?
Well, first of all, in the beginning, great special effects. When she was on fire and she didn't show any emotion or any pain, I thought that was wonderful. And that wasn't, I mean, done by any sort of trickery. That was basically just her. They set a real woman on fire. They put flame retardant clothes on her and flame retardant makeup. And they set her on fire. And so, she died, still.
Is that why she didn't get burnt? Because those flames were retarded?
Yep. She didn't get burnt because the flames were retarded.
Okay. Reagan, I loved your tap dancing in the movie. when you were up there on stage tap dancing in the rehearsals, that part really hit home to me because, as Mike knows, we took tap dancing and we love it. It's a part of our life. And was that part true?
Well, actually, I'm very skilled as a juggler, and Linda Blair didn't know how to juggle, so basically they taught her how to tap dance in a day, and so that became her talent, and that's what she did. So, I mean, I'm not sure she's really into it anymore, but basically she couldn't juggle the way I could. I'm actually quite skilled at it.
So you're saying The Exorcist 2, The Heretic is a bunch of bullshit because you were a juggler and she's a tap dancer, and why the fuck are we even reviewing this movie if this movie is such bullshit?
It's not necessarily bullshit, it's just that they have to take liberties here and there. I mean, if the actress who plays me can't do juggling, then clearly...
Who's
which is
they?
Special skill.
The devil? Who's they?
They being Linda Blair.
I'll give you a coupon to Orange Julius.
Thank you.
I'll take that, actually. That'd be cool.
Here you go. Here's three.
Oh, thanks.
So you say you're a really good juggler.
Yeah.
Do you think that's why you were possessed?
No, I don't think that's why I was possessed.
But what if the thing, the entity that possessed you, just wanted to juggle?
Well, maybe it did, but like I said before, the demons are not happy people. They're not coming back to juggle. They're coming back to kill.
They're evil things.
Evil.
Richard Burton in the film was quoted as saying, "Today, wherever I look, I see evil. God has fallen silent."
Now, did Richard Burton just walk in the studio?
No, that was me. It was me. I've got more.
Evil is a spiritual being, alive and living, perverted and perverting, weaving its way very insidiously throughout the fabric of life.
I love the quote, but I don't get it.
That gave you
Sir Richard Burton,
just...
welcome to the show.
Yeah. No, it's me, Mike. It's me.
You gave me chills. You sound just like him.
Thank you. Mm. I mean, I do impressions occasionally, but... I really loved the quote. I mean, I like the words and the letters, the way they're aligned with the spaces and everything, but I don't understand what it means.
I think he was talking about doing a crossover movie with Exorcist and Star Wars.
That would be...
That's what it sounded like to me.
I think he's just trying to get laid.
He's asking Nurse Ratchet for sex?
Yeah, oh yeah. People brought together in high-stress situations, they usually end up hooking up afterwards. Little-known fact, everyone on the Titanic drowned while making love to each other.
That sounds lovely. Yeah, that's a good way to go.
Yeah, that's what was going on.
Who was the captain making love to? Was he making love to the ship?
Well, I mean, because of his duties to the ship, he had to go down with the ship, you know, so to speak, so... They found him with the steering wheel jammed so far down his throat that they couldn't tell what was wood and what was captain. Because they still made steering wheels out of wood back then.
I thought you were talking about wood, like penis wood. Never mind.
That's disgusting.
Reagan MacNeil.
Sorry.
We hardly ever talk about penises or peni on this show.
Peni, yeah, the plural for penis. More than one penis is peni.
Everyone knows that.
I know it.
OJ
Simpson knows that.
OJ actually has more than one penis.
Yeah, I got peni.
He's got peni.
I'm going to show this crazy girl my peni.
No, I'm good. Thank you.
And well, she's not crazy. She was in a psychiatric ward.
Thank you.
A bin for loonies.
That's the politically correct way to put it, I think.
Thank you, Mike.
Were you still possessed while this movie was being filmed?
Like I said, it comes and goes. There were parts, during the filming, which was, over 3 months. So, I don't know, probably 16 times, something like that.
That's it.
Jesus.
Yeah.
Since the filming, you've been possessed how many times?
Oof, I can't count that high. It's It could happen at any time, really.
That's terrifying.
It is, OJ. It is.
Yeah, that's as scared as I've ever seen OJ Simpson.
Whoa.
What's happening? What's happening?
What's going on?
The glass is shaking. The glass on my wrist.
Oh my god. Oh my god, Regan O'Neill. Oh, MacNeil, what is going on? Mike.
This is scary shit.
Wait a second. Wait. The lights just went out. The lights are out.
Her head is spinning around. She's
Oh my god.
She's vomiting. Oh, it's gross. It smells delicious.
So much more attractive like this.
Thank you.
Oh my god. Regan MacNeil, is this... Who are we speaking to right now?
Jack.
Jack
the Ripper.
Wait, no, I know who this is. Jack Nicholson, PGA Tour. No. Jack Nicholson.
No, I hate golf. Golf sucks.
I agree with that.
OJ plays golf. Ask him.
Yeah, golf's good.
All right, fair enough. Okay.
Wow, she's hissing and spitting everywhere, all over the studio. We're going to need some Mexican women to clean this place.
That's racist.
Is that blood coming out of her eyes?
Oh. Jack, why are you possessing Regan MacNeil?
Because it's the only way I can tell people how much I like Star Wars.
You wanted to talk about Star Wars.
Oh my god.
I knew you guys were talking about it. Was it? Hey, I want to come talk about Star Wars.
Jack, you're actually late. We talked about Star Wars a couple of months ago on the show. Not now. We're actually not talking about it now. But a lot of people are wanting to talk about it, it seems like.
I want to talk about it.
So you possessed Regan MacNeil.
Yes.
You're here to talk to us on the Tim and Mike Entertainment Show about Star Wars?
I love Star Wars. It is absolutely the most amazing movie ever.
God,
I love Princess Leia.
Oh my god. I mean, welcome to the show, Jack the Ripper. I don't know. No offense, but I would have thought you would have had better taste in movies.
Moving along.
Oh yeah, let's move past this.
Let's get back to The Exorcist 2. At one point, Nurse Ratched asks priest Richard Burton if he ever needs a woman. First of all, that was kind of a rude thing to ask a priest. But second of all, I had heard that they cut a scene where Richard Burton explained in detail, being a priest, he can't date, but he can have sex with prostitutes every once in a while. They cut that whole scene, though.
I saw the uncut version, so I got to see the whole scene.
You saw that part. Okay. I heard that scene was like 20 minutes long.
Yeah, all he does is talk about being able to have sex with women and do a bunch of drugs in dingy hotel rooms and how the Catholic Church allows priests to do this.
Now, I heard that Richard Burton, the actor, was really pissed that that they cut it because it made his priest character look like a fag. And fag is slang for gay, if you haven't heard.
Right, not a cigarette if you're from,
that's what we call them in England.
Right. Right.
Thank you. Yeah. Thanks,
Jack the Ripper knows. Fag is not offensive to gay people. It's sort of like calling like a Cuban a wetback. You know, they don't mind because it's true.
Yeah, they don't mind at all. They don't mind because it's the truth.
Back to Exorcist 2. Why were they shooting guns at the bees? And why are there so many bees? And Regan, did you get attacked by bees while you were possessed?
Well, I think she's not Regan anymore. This is Jack the Ripper.
Oh, Jack.
Right.
Well, I'm allergic to bees.
I've got an EpiPen. No worries, OJ.
Good looking out, Mike.
So James Earl Ray is the devil the whole time. And he's
James Earl Ray Jones. James Earl Jones, Ray Jones.
And he's got this deep voice, and it's just terrifying. And now this guy...
Maybe he's possessed.
He could be possessed. He was the devil in this movie, and he was the devil in Star Wars.
Yeah, I hear that's just his studio voice. I mean, I know I've heard in real life people that have talked to him, he's got a real high-pitched, almost womanly tone.
Mike, do you have anything else to say about The Exorcist 2, The Heretic?
Yeah, shockingly enough, I have absolutely nothing to say about this film any more than I already have said.
Except that you completely loved it?
I completely loved it. It's going to win at least an Oscar or two. Sir Richard Burton, John Borman, this will be his calling card. I said it before, this will be John Borman's calling card. He's got, Excalibur than this.
It was an amazing film. Clearly Borman's best. It blew away the first one. The Exorcist 2 will stand the test of time, unlike this movie that everyone apparently wants to talk about today, Star Wars.
It's amazing.
I disagree, Jack.
Boring.
Well, thank you everybody for appearing on Tim and Mike's entertainment show today. O.J. Simpson, what are you going to do after the show?
I'm your boogeyman, Mike. I'm your boogeyman.
Sell all your stock in Apple.
Jack, where are you going to go see another movie?
No, I'll probably just go kill people.
You're just going to go kill people in Reagan's body?
Yeah.
Okay.
Cheerio.
We won't bother alerting the authorities.
Thank you.
It seems pretty pointless.
Cheers.
Okay. Well, cheers. Maybe we'll get a pint at the pub after the show.
Sure.
Well, thank you, everybody, for listening to The Exorcist 2 with guests Regan MacNeil and O.J. Simpson. Mike, do you have anything else to say?
Free Ted Bundy!
Thank you for listening to podcasts from the past. Follow our guests on Twitter. O.J. Simpson is Adam Souter at Adam Souter. Regan MacNeil is Liz Wicker. Tune in next time or else we'll rip your toenails off, you jerk.